come this morning to worship God. Happy are those whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God, who made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, who keeps faith forever, who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. So as we start our time of worship, we remember that God who asks us to be loving, helping everybody around us, staying and following the example of our Saviour, and also looking after the world of creation, which is why I chose our first hymn, which is "Think of a World Without Any Flowers." So now we come together in prayer. God of grace and glory, we come to you in awe and wonder, for you are the Lord of all creation. You've made us in your image and likeness and called us to be your children. You've chosen us to be your heirs and invited us to share in your kingdom. So help us to worship you in spirit and in truth, to listen to your word with faith and obedience, to receive your grace with humility and gratitude, and to share your love with justice and mercy. So generous God, thank you for the blessings of each day, for friends and neighbours, work and leisure, nature and beauty. Merciful God, thank you that you set prisoners free and bring about justice for the oppressed. You watch over strangers and uphold the vulnerable. All praise to your glorious name. But Lord, we confess that we don't always welcome people as you do. We have passed judgment on others instead of looking at them with love. We've been impressed by status, wealth, possessions, rather than seeing the whole person. Forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Help us to be doers of the word and not just hearers. And so, loving God, we thank you for your free and generous forgiveness. We receive it in humility and with joy as we say together the prayer your Son gave us, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. So I'm hoping that now you're going to see the words on the screen and hear the music of Hey Jude.
Hey Jude, don't make it bad. Take a sad song and make it better. Remember to let her into your heart. Then you can start to make it better. Hey Jude, don't be afraid.
Books in the New Testament that's not read or studied much is the letter of Jude. Like Paul, Timothy, and Peter, Jude was writing to a particular church, probably in the early 17th century. What church it was, who Jude was, we don't know. And perhaps that's why Thomas Hardy entitled his novel Jude the Obscure. But the name clearly caught the attention of the Beatles, Paul and John. But instead of sending a message to an unknown church, they are sending a letter to Jude. And their message is encouraging Jude to let love into his heart. And with that love, making life better. And I have to admit that I've rather given up keeping abreast with popular music, so I don't really know now whether the messages are as thoughtful as I like to think that most of the songs in the 50s, 60s and 70s were. And you might think it's a bit odd using a pop song to spread God's message. But yesterday in Leiston, we had our book festival, the first we've ever had. And there were six speakers and they were all talking about books that they've just written. And one of the speakers spoke at length about the importance of song or story at giving us a sense of the direction we should be going in, hoping that we could help us to look into the future with hope in this world of climate change. And you might remember that Paul wrote to Timothy saying all scripture is inscribed by God. For him, as for us, scripture means words from the Bible. But I've been thinking, I'm beginning to feel that I've lived a very long life and I've read a lot of books. Some of them are fiction, some of them are non-fiction, and I've learnt a lot from them in similar ways to those that Paul listed from Scripture. He said it was for teaching. I've certainly learnt a lot. For reproof, I've often thought, yes, I shouldn't be doing that. For correction, same thing. For training in its righteousness. And a thought reinforced by my experience of yesterday, for training in love. Love in all its forms. And the contents of the books have enabled me to share with the Beatles the realization that love can make things better. Both God's love and human love. So I think we could say, instead of remember to let her into your heart, we could actually say, remember to let Jesus into your heart. Then you can start to make it better. And I was very tempted. I thought, oh, shall I choose another Beatles song for us all to sing? And then I thought, no. And I looked in Rejoice and Sing at the People of God section, which is where I chose Let There Be Love. Now we have our reading from Mark.
The reading from Mark 7, verses 32 to 37. Some people brought a man who could neither hear nor speak and asked Jesus to lay a healing hand on him. He took the man off by himself, put his fingers in the man's ears and some spit on the man's tongue. Then Jesus looked up in prayer, groaned mightily and commanded, "Ephatha, open up." And it happened. The man's hearing was clear and his speech plain, just like that. Jesus urged them to keep it quiet, but they talked it up all the more, beside themselves with excitement. "He's done it all and done it well. He gives hearing to the deaf, speech to the speechless." This is the word of the Lord.
We hear quite often Jesus saying, you know, "Don't tell anybody," and you think, I don't know how he thinks we won't. It's so exciting. And nowadays, of course, with health and safety, we might say, don't know whether his medical methods are quite right. But I guess if you were deaf and dumb, any method that worked would be acceptable. And I guess at times we do all wonder how we would cope if we lost hearing, seeing, or speaking. And looking around, I can see, you know, quite a few of us wearing glasses, so we've obviously thought, oh, I don't know, can't quite see properly. I have glasses, and you perhaps can't see them, but I can't hear properly, so I've got hearing aids, but I'm still able to speak. But if you lost it completely, you know, how would you communicate if you couldn't speak? How would you cross the road if you couldn't see the cars? How could you hear the news if you hadn't got any hearing? So I think not only did Jesus transform that man's life physically, but also socially. Because it allowed him then to become a full member of the community. He could join the spiritual community in the synagogue. Now, I don't want any of you to go away suggesting that I'm saying we should be sticking our fingers in people's ears and spitting on their tongues. But we can heal people. If not physically, we can heal social loneliness, emotional turmoil, and mental health problems. I mentioned my grandchildren a bit earlier. And the twins' birthday next Saturday. And one of the twins has just been assessed as being autistic or on the autistic spectrum. So we are now learning how to deal with her problems by the way we explain things, by trying not to overwhelm her with choices. When they came to stay with me for a week, I didn't realize what a minefield breakfast was. Instead of saying you're having crisps or cocoa pops or whatever, I said cheerily, "No, well, you can have this, this," and she can't take that. And then she gets cross because I don't understand. And we have to keep to a routine because she's frightened of change. So my daughter is learning that healing can just be talking quietly and calmly to somebody who is agitated. And if you think about the Bible, that's just what Jesus did to the man in the graveyard who had mental problems. And we get lots of other examples if we look at Jesus the healer, and examples that we can follow. We can release people from emotional, spiritual, mental, physical boundaries that make their lives a misery. Having friends like us can help give confidence to face up to the boundaries. Like those friends who lowered their friend down to be healed by Jesus. Much less spectacular. But just popping in to see somebody housebound can cheer up a solitary day. And being aware that somebody's finding it hard to cope and offering them assistance is also an act of healing. As that lame man at the pool of Bethesda found, when Jesus healed him, having realised that the man couldn't reach the water in time. So let's just sit quietly for a moment or two to think of other acts of healing that Jesus did and try and link them with the ways in which we can be healers too. Loving Lord, we thank you for all the ways in which you show us how to be your healers. Jesus healed, and in his request to the crowd to be quiet, he affirmed that he wasn't looking for any reward save that of knowing he did his Father's will. Help us to care for others in the same quiet way. Amen. I sometimes get fixated on sections in the Rejoice and Sing, which I'm afraid I still use. And so this is another one from the People of God. And we're going to share with Jesus that caring for people around us so that we weep when people weep and we laugh when they laugh. So it's brother, sister, let me serve you.
I, Jude, am a slave to Jesus Christ and brother to James, writing to those loved by God, the Father, called and kept safe by Jesus Christ. Dear friends, I've dropped everything to write to you about this life of salvation that we have in common. I have to write insisting, begging that you fight with everything you have in you for this faith entrusted to us as a gift to guard and cherish. What has happened is that some people have infiltrated our ranks. Our scriptures warned us that this would happen. Who beneath their pious skin are shameless scoundrels. Their design is to replace the sheer grace of our God with sheer license, which means doing away with Jesus Christ, our one and only Master. These are the grumpers, the belly achers, grabbing for the biggest piece of the pie, talking big, saying anything they think will get them ahead. But remember, dear friends, that the apostles of our Master Jesus Christ told us this would happen. In the last days, there will be people who don't take these things seriously anymore. They'll treat them like a joke and make a religion of their own whims and lusts. These are the ones who split churches, thinking only of themselves. There's nothing to them. No sign of the Spirit. But you, dear friends, carefully build yourselves up in this most holy faith by praying in the Holy Spirit, staying right at the centre of God's love, keeping your arms open and outstretched, ready for the mercy of our Master, Jesus Christ. This is the unending life, the real life. And now to him who can keep you on your feet, standing tall in his bright presence, fresh and celebrating. To our one God, our only Saviour through Jesus Christ, our Master, be glory, majesty, strength, and rule before all time. And now, and to the end of all time. Yes.
I slightly rethought my focus on Jude. First of all, I thought, yeah, he's the one who's telling people to be careful. And then I realised it's not so much that he wanted people to be careful, but rather that he wanted them to stay firm in their faith, in love. So like Jude's friend in the song, the biblical Jude, too, wanted his readers, his hearers, to keep love at the forefront, but also to be aware of those leading them astray. So we don't quite know exactly who they were, but apparently these were false teachers who were trying to convince believers that once you've been saved, you've been saved forever. And so that gave you the license to sin, because your sins would no longer be held against you. And Jude thought it imperative that his readers be on guard against such people and be prepared to oppose their perverted teaching with the truth about God's saving grace. And I thought to myself, yep, I think we are surrounded by similar false teachers trying to persuade us to share their views of faith and ways of living. Jude said, these are the grumpers, the belly achers, grabbing for the biggest piece of the pie, talking big, saying anything they think will get them ahead. I've decided that it's the grumpers and the belly achers nowadays who so often try to get us to share in their gloomy view of the world. They always seem to be moaning. There's always something wrong. Life is never nice. While the grabbers whisper to us that, as Christians, you should be making sure that you do really well in worldly ways. So battle show other people what a great value it is to go to church. And rather than talking big, let's remember Paul's injunction to boast not of ourselves, but of our Saviour, Jesus Christ, because it's he who leads us as his disciples, not the worldly go-getters. It can seem a bit gloomy, I expect, to think that Jude's message still rings true after all these centuries. And so I thought, I must do something about this, so I looked it up. And when you look at the whole world, and not just our little island, instead of saying, oh dear, people aren't going to church, there's hope and joy based on the people of God working for the kingdom. We are with another 2.4 billion people who are still following Jesus, staying firm in the faith, and we share their work. So we face the problems of the present world just as they do, trying to come to terms with change, trying to discern God's purpose for his church, trying to come to terms with incomers coming into the church who might not see or think things the way we do, or do things in the way we've always done it that way. So Jude's message about staying firm is very apposite. So his final words I will repeat again. But you, dear friends, carefully build yourselves up in this most holy faith by praying in the Holy Spirit, staying right at the center of God's love, keeping your arms open and outstretched, ready for the mercy of our Master, Jesus Christ. This is the unending life, the real life. So, that message focuses really on the Holy Spirit, on God, Father, and our Master Jesus, as we try to live our lives for others. So that's why I chose our next hymn, which is For Ourselves No Longer Living.
Thank you.
And so we come together in prayer. As we look around your world, Lord, we keep in our hearts and minds those places so desperately in need of your care, love, and guidance, and ask you to help us play our part as much as we can. Unite us to be peacemakers, overflowing with the wish to build peace among people, to share abundance, to promote human rights, to give up making arms and make ploughshares and tractors instead. Empower us to be justice workers, full to the brim with the desire to speak truth to evil, to dismantle oppression and liberate the occupied. Show us how to walk your path, acknowledging and sharing the abundance that the world gives us. Guide us in those ways of peace and justice. We ask in the name of your Son, our Saviour, and your guide, the Holy Spirit. Amen. The last hymn came from the discipleship section, and the last one we're going to sing, because it takes us out with the pictures of the kingdom to guide us through the week. And it's from Christ's life and ministry, and it's "The Kingdom of God is Justice and Joy."
Thank you.
The ending of our worship is the beginning of our future. Bless us, God of gifts and God of glory. Bless us as we carry on your story. And may your blessing, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, rest with us now and remain with us and with all your people through the coming week. Amen.